An Ocean Apart is made possible in part by British Airways, whose club class delivers the business traveler ready to do business. Hansen, a company which has provided basic goods and services since 1964 and attained increased profits, dividends, and earnings per share every year. Hansen, here today, here tomorrow. And by this and other public television stations.
In December 1956, the British Army was withdrawn from Egypt and returned home. The lion's tail was between its legs. The attempt to recapture the Suez Canal from Nasser had ended in military and political confusion. Britain had been humiliated by the country she thought of as her ally, the United States. It had denounced her at the United Nations and ordered her to withdraw her troops or risk the collapse of the pound. Prime Minister Eden resigned, and his successor tried to lift the nation's spirits.
Every now and again since the war, I've heard people say, isn't Britain only a second or third class power now? Isn't she on the way out? What nonsense. This is a great country, so don't let's be ashamed to say so.
Harold Macmillan's attempt to bolster British morale couldn't disguise the scale of the defeat that Britain had suffered at Suez. Her claim to be a world power able to defend her own interests had been proved to be a sham. The United States had demonstrated that it could and would intervene to frustrate Britain's aims if they came into conflict with its own. That American intervention had been a success, but it had left Britain's alliance with her oldest, closest, most powerful friend in tatters. Harold Macmillan wrote in his diary that to rebuild it was now his most urgent and delicate task. In 1957, President Eisenhower, re-elected for a second term, swore allegiance to an America that had never seemed so prosperous or so secure. But within months of his inauguration, confidence was shaken by unexpected and unwelcome news.
This is Radio Moscow.
As a result of intensive work by research institutes and designing bureaus, the first artificial Earth satellite in the world has now been created. This first satellite was today successfully launched in the USSR. At the present time, the satellite is describing elliptical trajectories around the Earth.
The nuclear devastation, which had seemed only a nightmare, was now a real possibility. If Sputnik could invade space, Russia could launch a missile attack anywhere on Earth. American cities, which had always been immune, had become vulnerable overnight.
I said, we should have been the first ones to have it, if there's such thing.
It gets the American people alarmed that a foreign country, especially an enemy country, can do this, and we fear this.
If I was in military service and fell down on a job like that, I could stand a court-martial. Somebody's fallen down on a job, badly.
America's pride was hurt, and the public looked to Eisenhower to restore the lead they'd lost. Its missiles weren't yet powerful enough to hit Russia from the United States, but they could reach their target if fired from Britain. So restoring the old friendship seemed sensible, and the sooner the better.
The Eisenhower-Macmillan relationship went back quite a long way. It went back to the time they were together in Algiers. Macmillan had been one of the two political advisors to Eisenhower. He had a number of people in his life that he had worked with, for whom he and really treasured a great respect. And that was true in the case of Macmillan.
Eisenhower and Macmillan had already begun to heal the breach between their countries soon after Suez. Sputnik made the reconciliation all the more urgent. Eisenhower had asked Macmillan to help strengthen America's defenses, and in return, he offered to share the latest technology with Britain. This is one of the first ballistic missiles capable of carrying a nuclear warhead, the American-built Thor. It was an intermediate-range missile. It could reach the Soviet Union only if it was fired from a forward base. Britain provided the ideal site. And so Eisenhower and Macmillan struck a deal over Thor, a bargain which was designed to suit their needs at the time, but which laid the foundations of a complex and potent nuclear relationship which has lasted to the present day. As the bases were prepared for Thor, one question had still to be answered. Who would fire the missile, Britain or America? It was decided that neither should act without the other. Two keys, one American, one British, had to be operated for a launch. It was a formula nearly undermined by a television interview with the American officer in charge of Thor's deployment.
Well, they interviewed us and they asked us what we were going to do. And, of course, naturally, I gave them the answer that I'd been briefed on. We're going to England with the Thor missiles. And we're going to man the Thors until the British are ready to man the Thors. And that's all I said, in essence. And boy, the whole roof caved in after the program. I got a call from General Thomas White, who was our chief of staff. And his comment to me was, Zink, whatever you are saying, don't say it anymore.
Macmillan was angered by Zink's claim to be in operational command of Thor. He wrote in his diary, Colonel Zink's put his foot in it on the grand scale. The American alliance is continually being put in jeopardy by the folly of American officers. Denials were swiftly issued by the American Defense Department, and Zink paid the price for his incautious remarks.
General Blanchard again called me in and said, Zink, unfortunately, you're not going to be squadron commander. You're going to be on my staff. And so I said, well, you know, so that's the breaks of the game. Why? I said, well, the British don't want Colonel Zink over here with his hand on the missile button.
The dual key control was for America's peace of mind as much as Britain's. The 60 Thor missiles amounted to a massive increase in the West's nuclear firepower. And though marked with the British insignia and in theory part of Britain's deterrent, Thor was less British than it seemed.
The Americans lent us Thor. But when I say lent the RAF Thor, and Thor was under RAF control, manned by RAF crews. And installed in East Anglia. I went and saw the Thor missiles several times. Their only anxiety was that we might use them without their permission. And that's where the dual key came in. That there was a small American team at each Thor base. So we couldn't activate the system without their consent.
So there was no mutual trust. Well, not absolute trust.
Not absolute trust, no. I mean, here was an extremely dangerous weapon which could hit Moscow. And the Americans were beginning to be frightened, once the Russians had got their own thermonuclear weapons, that we might start a war when Europe was threatened, which they didn't want to get involved in.
The arrival of Thor was the start of a major new build-up of nuclear systems in Britain. Critics complained the country was becoming an offshore base for America, with nuclear submarine depots, early warning stations, and communications posts. And when de Gaulle expelled the American nuclear bomber force from France, they too were redeployed to East Anglia.
American reconnaissance jets come into land on an airfield in England, and they're home again. To the United States 3rd Air Force, England has always been home. They were formed here in 1948, and the force has had its headquarters in Britain ever since.
We referred to East Anglia as the 49th state, mainly because there were so many Yanks there. And primarily, the Yanks had been there before in World War II. There were brand new Yanks coming. We were taking over flight operations from the RAF. There were so many of them there, and so many English people who had been related to girls who married GIs, that you could go into a pub and have ice in your drink, which you couldn't get anywhere else in England at the time. And it got to a point, it was a suburb of New York or Chicago or wherever you came from, because there would be somebody in a town close to where you were stationed, had been there or had a daughter, marry a Yank and went back there.
From the late 1950s, Britain's nuclear links with America grew stronger year by year. Britain's own nuclear deterrent was carried by her elegant but outdated V bomber force. Macmillan needed a new delivery system if he was to stay in the big league.
It was clear that there are free-falling bombs from the V bomber force. We're nearing the end of their life. I mean, they could probably go on another 5 or 6 years or 8 years, but you couldn't hope to get through the Russian defenses after that time. So we had to get a standoff weapon. We were very attracted by Skybolt, which the United States Air Force wanted for themselves and wanted us to have as well.
Skybolt was not yet in production, but Eisenhower agreed to sell it to Macmillan in return for Britain accommodating one more American weapon system. What Eisenhower wanted was a safe harbor in Western Europe to service the most sophisticated weapon yet devised, the submarine-launched Polaris missile. Macmillan offered Holyrock in Scotland as a base. The decision had been kept secret, and the arrival of the Polaris fleet caused some alarm.
Their primary concern were radiation levels. They wanted to be reassured that there wasn't going to be any nuclear accident. They were much more concerned about that than they were about the weapon system itself. They just didn't want any leaks. And of course, I could reassure them that I had 4 children in the Holy Lock, as did most of the families, and that we weren't the least bit worried about it, and we didn't want them to be worried about it either.
Something like a quarter of a mile from the ship, and we'd have a campfire and cook ourselves tea there, our meals there. We'd even build canoes. We'd get canvas and be able to build the canoes on the beach and then straight into the water the moment something arrived. You never actually twig that a ship is like a block of flats going up, and in fact leaning outwards. I couldn't swim, but we had great faith in these Ministry of Trade or Board of Trade life jackets.
From the minority of anti-nuclear objectors, the proposal to base Proteus in Holy Lock was unpopular.
Macmillan was determined to have nuclear weapons because he didn't believe Britain could remain a great power without them. With them, her prime minister would be a world statesman. In 1959, he visited Khrushchev, the Soviet leader, in an effort to thaw the Cold War and to arrange an East-West summit meeting. But a dramatic incident was to destroy the summit almost before it had begun. An American U-2 spy plane was shot down flying over Russian territory. The wreckage was put on display in Moscow. When Eisenhower refused to apologize for the incident, Khrushchev broke off the summit, and Britain's attempt to keep a place for herself at the top table had failed.
I've never seen Harry Macmillan so depressed as he was on the latter part of that meeting, because his whole object had been to try and act as the bringer together of these two powers. And he found that he hadn't got the strength, Britain on its own, hadn't got the strength to force either side to come together.
It was the last time Britain would attend a superpower summit. As Eisenhower prepared to retire, Macmillan wrote sadly to his old friend, "I'll try my best to keep our governments and our two countries on the same course, but I can never hope to have anything to replace the sort of relations we have had."
In the greatest story of a momentous year, John F. Kennedy defeated GOP standard bearer Richard Nixon in one of the closest presidential elections on record. The youngest man ever elected president takes the burden from the oldest ever to hold the office as America enters the critical and challenging 60s.
Kennedy's election brought an era to an end. As he himself reminded America, a younger, more vigorous administration was now in charge.
Let the word go forth from this time and place to friend and foe alike that the torch has been passed to a new generation of Americans born in this century, tempered by war, disciplined by a hard and bitter peace.
Kennedy brought a new breed into government, intellectuals from the universities and business, who were to re-examine American policy and the principles behind it. It seemed to Macmillan that any cozy assumptions about the relationship between Britain and America might now be in jeopardy.
I saw Harold Macmillan, who was then Prime Minister, shortly after Kennedy had been elected president. And he had heard that I was a friend of Kennedy's, and he wanted to know more about the man. He said to me, "You know, I've had such a marvelous relationship with Ike. We knew each other in Algiers during the war. We belonged to the same generation. We had a similar outlook on the world. And now there is this young, cocky Irishman in the White House. How am I going to establish this kind of special relationship with him?"
Macmillan needn't have feared. The new president, over 20 years his junior, responded warmly to the elder statesman, one of the few world leaders to whom he could talk without interpreters. Kennedy admired his patrician manner. He took Macmillan into his confidence and was soon referring to him as Uncle Harold.
In less than 4 years, Fidel Castro, who came to power on a wave of personal popularity, has allowed...
In October 1962, Kennedy faced the most frightening crisis of his presidency. Fidel Castro, the Cuban leader, had allowed Russia to start building a missile site in Cuba.
Within the past week, unmistakable evidence has established the fact that a series of offensive missile sites is now in preparation on that imprisoned island.
Kennedy's announcement that America was blockading Cuba to prevent any more Russian ships getting through brought Russia and America to the brink of war. Each night of the crisis, Kennedy spoke by telephone to Macmillan.
President Kennedy faced a problem of credibility on the first day of the missile crisis. And it was the British who advised him to make public the air photographs of the missile sites in Cuba. And President Kennedy did so over the objections of a number of people in our intelligence community. Well, as soon as he released those photographs of the missile sites, the credibility problem simply disappeared.
When Russia backed down, Macmillan claimed Britain had not been inactive during the trial of strength. But according to Kennedy's officials, it was only a supporting role.
I think the real solution came in direct contacts between President Kennedy and Mr. Khrushchev. I don't believe that Britain played the role of an intermediary or anything of that sort. But fortunately, Mr. Khrushchev decided to withdraw the missiles.
At the White House, there was jubilation over the way the crisis had been resolved. But whatever part Britain had played, it failed to avert a gathering storm over the relationship. Robert McNamara, the new defense secretary, was undertaking a review of all American defense spending. Among the weapons he wanted to cancel was Skybolt, the nuclear missile which Eisenhower had promised to Macmillan. Skybolt, according to McNamara, was too expensive and behind schedule. When the news broke in London, there was consternation.
My understanding was that Bob McNamara had explained to his British colleagues that Skybolt was in deep, deep trouble. But apparently the cabinet and the parliament were not prepared for the possibility of a cancellation of Skybolt.
And if I may say with a smile, I think it's possible that the surprise in London was somewhat exaggerated as part of the bargaining position in order to get further nuclear cooperation from the United States.
Dean Rusk may have thought the British government was exaggerating, but in London they felt they had plenty to worry about, and they were particularly upset by a famous speech that was made here at the West Point Military Academy in December 1962 by the revered elder statesman, the former Secretary of State, Dean Acheson. He said of Britain, "Great Britain has lost an empire and has not yet found a role." And he went on to say, "The attempt to play a role apart from Europe, a role based on a special relationship with the United States, is about played out. In trying to act as a broker between Russia and the United States, Britain was conducting a policy as weak as its military power." In other words, this famous American was telling the British government, look, you're no longer a great power. You should stop posturing as though you were one. You should stop trading on a special relationship with the United States. You should go and join Europe, which is where you really belong.
Acheson's wild words have caused an international furore.
About this Acheson thing, Jack. It's Harold here. Harold Macmillan. M-A-C-R. I'm calling from London. Now, looky here. This thing doesn't represent the views of your government, does it? Oh. Well, goodbye then.
Just before Christmas, a worried Macmillan arrived in the Bahamas for a summit with Kennedy. Acheson's words were still ringing in his ears, and he knew he'd have a fight to get his way. Macmillan still believed that an American-supplied nuclear weapons system was the only way of guaranteeing Britain's status as a great power, and he had decided on the weapon he wanted.
We met in Nassau in that millionaire's compound. Everybody was quite extraordinary. And the first evening there was this barbecue on the beach, and everybody was drinking rum punches and so on, and along came Macmillan dressed for number 10. And I thought it was, you know, slightly ridiculous, an evening on the beach in the West Indies. And he was, you know, jovial and jolly, and eventually I sort of led him aside and said, "No, what do you want, Prime Minister?" And he just said, "Polaris."
The whole world is making a fuss about a sky bolt you came up to discuss. But you can be sure, definitely, we have the maximum security. We don't mind Russia saying this or that. Three cheers for Stars and Stripes and the Union Jack. Yes, I said welcome, welcome, Macmillan and Kennedy. Welcome, welcome. Your visit to Nassau will go down in history.
Kennedy arrived at Macmillan's headquarters with a conflict to resolve. He was aware that Macmillan needed a replacement for Skybolt for political reasons. Without it, his policy of depending on America would be made to look very foolish. But a powerful faction in the State Department wanted Kennedy to end Britain's nuclear pretensions once and for all. Her proper place, they thought, was as a medium-sized power in Europe, with America alone providing the West nuclear cover. The spokesman of this group was George Ball, a senior State Department official.
I was very determined to have the British begin to get out of the feeling that, you know, they were a great power because they had an empire which they no longer had, and that they had a nuclear weapon which the others didn't have, and they had a relationship with the United States which nobody else had. This seemed to be not very healthy, even for the British point of view.
Harold Macmillan made this really very moving statement. It wasn't exactly an appeal, but it was a statement of the historical position of this country and the proud way in which we'd fought in two wars, how we were much smaller but much less important perhaps in world terms, but still had a sense of our own importance in the world, our own fitness, and our own desire to play a proper part in the alliance and as allies and also as independent country. And, there wasn't a dry eye in the House, including mine. I mean, it was very, very moving.
Kennedy, I think, was very moved that his senior friend, Mr. Macmillan, was in jeopardy as a result of a United States decision. There was a feeling that Kennedy had that the British deserved to be a part of the nuclear club and just practical, political terms. He wasn't going to do this to an old friend whom he admired.
And why were you willing to do it to an old friend who you admired?
Well, I wasn't prepared to destroy the British deterrent. I was just not prepared to, or not anxious, to see it extended for a whole new generation, because I could see a lot of complications.
At Nassau, Kennedy sided with Macmillan. Britain became the only country, apart from the United States, to own the new powerful weapons system. The lesson of this special treatment was not lost on her neighbor across the channel.
A staggering blow is dealt to Western unity in this council hall in Brussels when France blackballs Britain from the common market.
De Gaulle's veto on Britain joining Europe confirmed the State Department's worst fears. The Nassau Agreement had played straight into his hands. He was able to use it as further evidence that Britain didn't seriously intend to become a European nation. It was just what Winston Churchill had said to De Gaulle during the war about Britain. Each time we're forced to choose between Europe and the open sea, we shall always choose the open sea. And so the State Department's grand design for a united Europe was frustrated once again by the one factor they could never control, the ties of sentiment and of history that bound Britain and America.
It is a sad time for all people. We have suffered a loss that cannot be weighed. For me, it is a deep personal tragedy. I know that the world shares the sorrow that Mrs. Kennedy and her family bear.
The election of Lyndon Johnson as president in 1964 showed that personality can affect political relationships. No ties of sentiment or experience made the former Texan senator particularly interested in Britain, and he had little in common with the new occupant of Downing Street, Britain's first socialist prime minister in a decade, Harold Wilson. The Johnson-Wilson years saw growing misunderstanding and distrust between Britain and America. The strongest influence of the era was not politicians, but a new breed of standard bearer. I'll pretend that I'm missing,
that lips I'm missing. New Yorkers turned out in force, and making allowance for an American accent, the screams might have been genuine Merseyside. George, John, Paul, and Ringo had found a new world to conquer.
The Beatles seduced the people of America into a 60s love affair with Britain, conducted with a gaiety that made much more impact than the grey world of politics. Johnson's welcome to Wilson at the White House was less effusive. Britain was back with her begging bowl. Wilson's election had been followed by a run on sterling, and he needed a $4 billion loan to shore up the economy. The loan was agreed, but with strings attached. The government would have to cut its spending plans, and some of Britain's more lavish projects were in jeopardy. The American defense establishment had some suggestions to offer. In 1965, the Americans were marketing a new fighter bomber, the F-111. For 6 years, Britain had been developing a similar plane, the TSR-2. The F-111 was now offered to Britain at half the price of her own plane, a deal which critics say began as an American attempt to kill off Concorde.
The Americans said to them, look here, yes, we let you have the money, but we don't see why we should subsidize prestige projects like the Concorde. And, of course, by this time, they were much more worried about the Concorde, as it was going ahead, and they would have nothing comparable. Anyway, we couldn't untie the I didn't want to, but even the Labour government wanted to, passionately, but they couldn't untie the treaty. So they went back to Washington and said so. And it's at that point, as far as I understand it, the Americans said, well, what else could you cancel? You've got this very expensive TSR-2, which is much the same as our F-111. Why don't you cancel the TSR-2 and we let you have the F-111 fairly cheap?
Britain cancelled TSR-2 in 1965. The prototypes were destroyed and an option taken to buy the American F-111. The government was accused of scrapping the project under pressure from the United States. The thousands of workers who lost their jobs believed the TSR-2 was better than its American alternative and that Britain had missed an opportunity. The Labour government argued that the plane had already cost too much and that Britain must learn to be more modest. So, in your view, no harm in buying American if it's the cheapest and best thing around?
There's obviously a risk if you become dependent on a single source for a major element in defence spending. But it's become obvious that a medium-sized country like Britain cannot produce everything it wants for itself the whole time. The Germans buy most of their stuff abroad. It hasn't damaged them economically. It hasn't damaged them in terms of civil R&D. It's probably given them more efficient forces than they'd have had if they tried to produce everything for themselves.
Vietnam, America's unwinnable war. Begun by Kennedy, fought with increasing ferocity by Johnson, abandoned by Nixon. The British government never supported this attempt to defend South Vietnam against a communist takeover from the North, however eloquently the case was put.
We do not want an expanding struggle with consequences that no one can foresee. Nor will we bluster, or bully, or flaunt our power. But we will not surrender. And we will not retreat.
Johnson was angry and disappointed by Wilson's reaction to the war. Wilson's support was lukewarm, often accompanied by attempts to arbitrate, and by private criticism of the way it was being fought, particularly of the big bombing raids. "I won't tell you how to run Malaysia," Johnson exploded, "and you don't tell me how to run Vietnam."
In World War II, the United States went to Britain. When she was in her darkest hour, we backed her up. So why couldn't she back us up now?
I don't feel that Britain is letting us down for feeling this way, but I don't think they should give up supporting us because they are our ally and they are to help us.
If Britain had sent a significant contingent of forces to Vietnam, it could have made a very important difference, particularly on the political side of things. The American people have taken some 600,000 casualties and dead and wounded since the end of World War II in support of collective security. And the effort has not been very collective. We put up 90% of the non-Korean forces in Korea, 80% of the non-Vietnamese forces in Vietnam. And this sense among the American people that we've been asked to do too much relatively alone is a very important consideration. And so had there been more flags flying in Vietnam, it could have made a substantial difference.
As the unending procession of the dead came home, with no victories to their names, many Americans began to doubt the wisdom of the course Johnson had set. The president, anxious to demonstrate that this was not an all-American folly, urged friendly allies to join the campaign in the interests of the free world.
We came under very heavy pressure. I remember Abel Harriman coming over once as special representative and saying, we must join the fight for democracy. I said, but what sort of democracy are we defending in South Vietnam? I said, look, we think you've made a great mistake, but you're friends of ours. We're not going to rub it in public, but don't ask us to say that we think you're fighting for freedom and justice and so on. We don't. We hope you'll get out of it as fast as you can.
I went to this party on the 7th floor of the State Department, and it was a very good party, lots to drink. And Dean Russ was a drinking man, bourbon and water, bourbon and branch, he called it. And the party went on for a long time, and he came over to me, and he looked down at me, he was a tall man, and he was perspiring. And he said, why didn't you send troops to Vietnam, Louis? And I said, Mr. Secretary, you know why. I mean, we've been over this before. And then he got very angry, and he said, why didn't you send just one battalion of the Black Watch? That would have been enough for us. Just one battalion of the Black Watch. And he paused and glowered at me and said, when the Russians invade Sussex, don't expect us to come and help you.
Britain was now giving up the last of her responsibilities around the globe. America, preoccupied in Vietnam, was uneasy about it. The United States had always urged Britain to disband the empire, but wondered whether her disappearance at this moment was wise.
I think as Britain began to withdraw from various parts of the empire, and you could see the flags coming down from New Delhi and Karachi and Nassau and Mauritius and all of these other areas of the world, it left the United States with a little bit of lonely feeling that our closest international partner was withdrawing from areas that we knew very little about, in which we didn't have a presence. And I think it was a cause for concern and anxiety in the United States.
The United States had become accustomed to Britain sharing the role of international policeman, and her retirement was bound to leave a gap. Under the pressure of a worsening financial crisis, the Labour government cancelled its order for new aircraft carriers. It then announced that most of its overseas troops in the Middle and the Far East, from the Persian Gulf to Singapore, were to be withdrawn. The Prime Minister flew to Washington to break the news to the President.
Harold Wilson often stays at Blair House, which is only proper when he visits Washington. This time, the British Prime Minister is staying here at the British Embassy. Protocol experts insist no slight was intended, but it's an open secret here that Harold Wilson is not one of the administration's favorite people at this time. Wilson arrived here last night, accompanied by his wife and top diplomatic and financial experts. Wilson was urged, almost begged by the administration, not to cut British forces in the Far East, but he did just that.
Britain's withdrawal came at a disastrous moment for Johnson. With the Viet Cong gaining ground, he had no troops to spare to protect other Western interests. But the Wilson government was committed to what the London Times called its wholesale slaughter of sacred cows and was not to be dissuaded. At a White House reception, Wilson was treated to a baritone singing a famous tribute to Britain's imperial greatness. Some saw it as a wry reminder from the president of what Britain had once been.
Up like thunder out of China across the bay.
The United States hadn't suddenly developed a love of the British Empire on its deathbed, but it believed Britain should have tried harder to maintain her influence in the more volatile parts of the world.
Certainly it was true at one time that the Americans seemed to be critical of the British because we had a large empire, and I think they sometimes felt that in the war we were more concerned about preserving our empire than about the defeat of Nazi tyranny. In the years after the war, they came to see that the sudden shrinking of Britain's imperial power was going to create problems in the world which would be problems for them have to solve.
The pink patches on the globe, the British Empire on which the sun never set, were vanishing fast. A dangerous vacuum was left in the Indian Ocean and Persian Gulf, where the Soviet Union was on the prowl and the United States had no bases. One British colony, instead of winning its independence, was virtually handed over to the United States, the arch anti-colonialist. Diego Garcia was a tiny island in the Indian Ocean,
Unfortunately for its inhabitants, this tropical paradise was ideally placed to serve as a giant military base. In a secret agreement, Britain forcibly removed its 1,000 residents and handed the island to the United States. In return, America lent the British £14 million to help pay for the Polaris missile system.
If one had not had access to Diego Garcia, there is no good substitute. What one would have had to do was to seek bases on the rimlands with all of the consequences that that has for having bases in populated areas and being forced out. What a wonderful thing it would have been had we been able to retain vestiges of the British Empire in that area. And without it, we've had to create the American equivalent, a huge facility on a barren atoll.
Did you feel it was right in the course of this to give one bit of territory to the Americans, the Diego Garcia base? Was that that seems almost like a transfer of a bit of empire.
Well, it was in a way, I suppose, and I think, in fact, it was probably an error. But at that particular time, they started building facilities on Diego Garcia at the time when we had facilities like that at Gan in the middle of the Indian Ocean. But I think, looking back on it, we made a mistake in doing so at the cost of transferring a lot of islanders against their will. But I suppose it was a thing that was difficult to deny them when it cost us so little and we were doing so many things they didn't like in other parts of the Third World.
As Britain shrugged off the responsibilities of empire, she seemed to gain a new vitality. The capital was now swinging London, its energies channeled into frivolity.
5 years ago it was Rome, and now it's London. Chelsea is very gay. Yes. I think it's great fun.
I think it's the image of the miniskirts and the pretty Carnaby Street and things like that. I think that's what makes London swinging.
The attitudes of the young, even the extravagance of their dress, was adapted from America's West Coast hippie culture. Critics said Britain was sinking, giggling, into the sea. The idea that faith should be put in love and individual freedom was nurtured by the war in Vietnam. A disaffected generation in America found it had growing support in Britain. The two governments might be at odds, but the young were united. On October the 27th, 1968, 70,000 demonstrators swirled through the streets of London. It was one of the biggest protests the city had ever seen.
I think the predominant view amongst young people in schools, which were very active in those days, polytechnics and campuses, were that they were the evil empire. That was the image of the United States then. The demonstrations in Britain against the war shocked the United States more than France or Germany or any of these other countries, because Britain had for a long time been regarded as the most loyal ally of the United States in Europe.
For many in Britain, the power of the United States no longer seemed benign. Instead, they saw a country engaged in an angry, futile attempt to impose its authority on a lesser power, and apparently destroying itself in the process. For those with memories of the close bonds forged in World War II, the sight of young Britons attacking the American embassy was shameful.
It wasn't just the ordinary demonstration, obviously. There was more passion really involved, more hostility and more frustration. And that doesn't make for a very pleasant scene.
Mm-hmm.
it. You were saddened by it. You felt, as we all did, this feeling of kinship to the UK, to see this demonstration of anti-American feeling. It left a bad taste, and it saddened you, really.
The violent demonstrations here outside the American embassy were mainly the work of the young, but they were by no means the only people in Britain concerned about America's presence in Vietnam. Britain's socialist government, though it never formally opposed America's presence, was nevertheless worried about her use of power and sought to modify it. But she was impotent to wield any influence. The two countries' roles were diverging. Britain, with her empire mainly gone, was giving up her overseas responsibilities. The United States, so long cautious about using power beyond her shores, was now striding the world stage with a new confidence, vividly demonstrated by the next president. Richard Nixon was determined to pull America out of the morass of Vietnam. Taking over from Johnson, he escalated the war, but maneuvered for peace. In 1972, he met Mao Tse-tung in communist China and enlisted his help in reaching a solution. He visited Brezhnev in Russia and ensured his acquiescence too. The war, which had alienated America from its allies, was ended. Britain, meanwhile, finally achieved what the United States had urged on her for so long. The new Conservative Prime Minister, Edward Heath, took her into Europe as a full member of the economic community. But Britain didn't act quite as America had hoped. Instead of being a loyal ally, America's voice in Europe, Heath wanted Britain to adopt a new approach.
The way Heath conceived it, it was intended as a revolution in Britain's post-war foreign policy, in the sense that he wanted to play down the special relationship with the United States and emphasize Britain's role as a European country and indeed as a leader of Europe. It didn't quite work that way, but I believe it has left Britain sort of suspended between the Heath conception and the old conception, and it neither became a leader of Europe nor did it retain the intimate ties with the United States. It still has very good ties with the United States.
Heath believed Britain had no future tagging along behind America, that she could never wield any influence on a world of superpowers except through Europe. America had to come to terms with the new arrangement. In October 1973, Heath's views were vividly illustrated. On the Jewish holiday of Yom Kippur, Egypt and Syria mounted a joint attack on Israel to avenge their defeat 6 years before. Russia supplied the Arabs, America the Israelis. Europe was threatened by the Arabs with the loss of oil supply. It allowed their bases to be used by the Americans. Britain took part in what Kissinger called a stampede of disassociation. Why did you decide not to allow British bases to be used?
Because in the Yom Kippur War, we took the position, the whole cabinet, the whole government, we were supported by Parliament, that we would be even-handed between the Arab world and Israel. We had been supplying goods to both, and when the Yom Kippur War broke out, we stopped supplying to both. And if we had accepted the request, then we would obviously have not any longer been equal-handed. We would have been leaning more to one side than the other, and that was not in British interests.
The fiercest fighting was here in the southern sector of the Suez Canal. I'm on the West Bank now, where the Israelis have been clearing all before them and cutting off the Egyptian Third Army.
A dramatic Israeli victory was in sight. The Egyptian Third Army was paralyzed and the road to Cairo open. The war was in danger of getting out of control, with Russia under pressure to save its allies. Washington was in the grip of its own crisis. The Watergate scandal was coming to a head, with President Nixon removing some of his closest advisers. At this moment, the Soviet Union warned Washington that it intended to send its own Russian troops to defend Egypt.
We reacted to a Brezhnev note, and you must recall that that was the very week that the first calls for Mr. Nixon's impeachment came about and the week of the firings. And as a consequence, we were fearful that the Soviet Union thought that the United States was so preoccupied with her domestic difficulties that it could not react to the Middle Eastern crisis and was prepared, therefore, to make a bold move that would have brought Soviet forces into Egypt and elsewhere into the Middle East. We had to react forcefully and we had to react quickly because we knew that Soviet aircraft were standing down in Eastern Europe. We had a meeting of the National Security Council as a consequence, and we decided to put the forces throughout most of the world on the alert.
Mr. Speaker, what's your understanding as to why there has been a military alert?
Well, there's only a precautionary alert, but the overwhelming emphasis is on diplomacy at this time.
Well, why is there an alert at all?
There's an alert because there is a serious situation in the Mideast, right. But it's precautionary.
Well, serious the situation meaning what?
Well, meaning that there have been ceasefire violations. That's all.
Congressman, one other question. Is this an effort to warn the Soviets?
Not that I know of, no.
The warning to Russia was clear. If they didn't back down, they risked massive American retaliation. The nuclear alert applied to all American bases in Britain, where America was thought to be under an obligation to consult the British government. All leave was cancelled, battle kits were worn, jets were armed, supplies were flown in around the clock. But Britain was told nothing until the decision had been implemented.
We could not consult the Allies because we thought we were under the impression that the Soviets were going to intervene that night. And after all, since the Europeans had dissociated themselves from us to begin with all through the crisis, but practically there was no other choice.
But it goes to the heart of things. The refusal by Britain to let you use the bases, followed by the nuclear alert without consulting Britain, and you make it sound like a sort of tit-for-tat.
No, it wasn't a tit-for-tat. What happened was that we got a message from Brezhnev, which we read as saying that he proposed joint intervention by the United States and the Soviet Union, and if we refused, the Soviet Union would intervene unilaterally.
I do recall that we all thought that the situation didn't demand a nuclear alert.
We had to act in the light of the best judgment that we could make of what the common interest was. So when one asks, was Britain put unnecessarily at risk? One has to define the word unnecessarily. Did we have a choice about it? In an ideal world, if we had had 3 days, we should have had consultation with Britain, and Britain should have had consultation with Europe, and we would never have convinced the Soviets that we were serious.
Is it actually practical in the modern age, with those weapons and the threat of thermonuclear war, to have joint decision-making on the use of bases?
Yes, no doubt about that at all.
Is there time for it?
Yes.
How can there be when split-second reactions are needed?
Well, because nobody can visualize a situation in which there isn't some form of build-up. And nobody can visualize a situation in which our intelligence, with all the modern devices of satellites, doesn't warn us of any possibility of a build-up. This, again, is mythology.
12 hours after the alert, the Soviets backed down. American troops stood easy. But in Washington, there was mounting fury at the way that Europe had behaved. By ignoring America's plea to put her case to the other European allies, Britain, it was said, had demonstrated where her true loyalties now lay. President Nixon was driven to issue a warning.
I do not mean to leave this question with the impression that the European and American alliance is shattered. It is not. I do indicate, however, that it is a time when the Europeans, as well as we, must sit down and determine that we are either going to go along together on both the security and the economic and political fronts, or we will go separately.
Britain and America now had important decisions to make. The United States had more than 300,000 troops stationed in Europe. After what was seen as the Allied betrayal in the Yom Kippur War, there was growing pressure in the United States to bring the boys home and let Europe defend itself. Kissinger commented, America and its democratic allies are drifting not only apart,
but into a competition. For Britain, there was a stark choice. She'd now experienced the difficulties of distancing herself from the United States and the resentment that it caused. Should she still try to make her own way in a united Europe, or should she revert to her old sanctuary under the eagle's wing?
An Ocean Apart is made possible in part by British Airways, whose club class delivers the business traveler ready to do business. Hansen, a company which has provided basic goods and services since 1964 and attained increased profits, dividends, and earnings per share every year. Hansen, here today, here tomorrow. And by this and other public television stations. An Ocean Apart, the companion book written by series host David Dimbleby and historical advisor David Reynolds, is available for $24.95 plus handling. To order by credit card, call 1-800-255-5990 or send a check or money order to An Ocean Apart, 5959 Triumph Street, Commerce, California 90040. Also available in bookstores.